Let's do some more applications, and the problems you'll see in these lectures are going to be where you have to read the words and formulate a mathematical equation so you can solve and get the answer. In order to do that, you should read the problem and understand what is being asked. Draw a rough sketch, because that might help you understand the dynamics amongst all the components. Assign variables for all the unknown quantities. Here are some guidelines on how you decide what quantities get variable. When you read a problem, if it says how much or how far, how long, find, when, these are some keywords you should look for, and that will tell you what your variables should stand for. In assigning variables, use letters that make sense. So for example, if it says how much time is required, then you would say T for time. Sometimes the problem tells you what variables to use, and then you have to use those variables, in which case pay careful attention to whether they are small letters or capital letters, because that can make a big difference. When using known formulas to solve a problem, try to organize information in a chart form, because that will help. And then sometimes you have to translate words into mathematical expressions, as we saw in Module 1. Let's review some of that here. So is translates mathematically to equal to sign, sum translates to addition, product is multiplication, square means to the power of 2, twice means 2 times. Substitute any known quantities into the formula and then solve for the missing variable. When working with equations and inequalities, solve for the unknown variable and always check your answer to see if it makes sense or if it satisfies the original equation. Also, see if the solution that you found makes sense to the problem that you're solving. Keep track of units throughout your work so that your final answer has appropriate units. And again, I cannot emphasize enough, please check your answer, and you should have some estimates in your head so that you know whether the answer you got is reasonable or not. Write your final answer always in a sentence that fits the question being asked with appropriate units. All right, so let's take some examples then. So at times, before you can do a problem, you might have to make some assumptions that the two quantities are related linearly, and most times they'll tell you whether they are related linearly. Assign variables to represent quantities that change or move. Come up with one or more equations that relate the variables, and then use the algebra tools we have developed so far, or you can solve a problem visually so that you understand what's going on. So let's start with this problem. Recipe calls for 1 3/4 cups of flour, 1/2 cup of sugar, 1 stick of butter. It's critical that these proportions are met so that your cookies turn out well. Paul was careless as he started and put 2 cups of flour instead of 1 3/4 cup and had added the sugar before realizing his error. Determine how much additional sugar and how much total butter he should use so that his cookies will turn out well. So what do you think we should do? I'm going to ask you to pause the video here and give this problem a try, and then we'll go over it. So go ahead, try it. Let's see what you come up with. Assuming you have paused and come back, let's take a look. Let's draw a picture to represent the original recipe. So we are asked to have 1 cup. Here's 1 cup, and here's 3/4 cup. So 1 3/4 cup of flour, 1/2 cup of sugar, and 1 stick of butter. That's our original recipe. Now, if you look at the proportions of flour to butter to sugar, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 pieces of flour. So let's take our sugar and break it into 7 parts. So you know that this 1/7 of a half is the amount that will go with this 1 strip of flour. You can do the same here, and this 1/7 of the butter will go with 1 strip of flour. That helps us understand what the proportions are, flour to sugar to butter. All right, let's take a look at what Paul did. Paul had 2 cups of flour. So instead of 1 3/4 cup, he has this 1 extra strip of flour. The sugar he already had added from the original recipe, and the butter he originally had, it would be that much. So what do you think we should do for the excess strip of flour? This excess strip of flour corresponds to 1 strip of sugar. So we need 1 extra strip of sugar and 1 extra strip of butter. And so that would be our solution then. So this is how much butter and sugar we need in addition to the original amount. And so our answer is going to be what then? We want to add 1/7 of 1/2, which is 1/14 cup of sugar, and 1 1/7 stick of butter. That will make the recipe come out well. Remember, we did not use any algebra. It was just a visual solution. In fact, when you're cooking, most often, this is probably the way you might solve the problem. You're not going to get a paper pencil and solve an algebra problem. All right, let's take another example. The tank on Carl's truck went from 1/3 full to 1/2 full when he added 4 gallons of gas. Use the information to determine how many gallons the tank holds when full. All right, so let's draw the truck. We have 1/3 and 1/2 represented in the same tank, so that's why we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 pieces in the tank. 1/3 will be 2 of them. So this is 1/3 full. Now, when you added 4 more gallons, it became 1/2 full. So 1/2 full would be this much more then. So that represents 4 gallons. And so our full gallon, so our full tank would be 4 times 6, or 24 gallons. So that's our visual solution. Let's see how we would do it algebraically. Since we don't know how many gallons the tank holds when full, let's call x the full capacity of the tank. Then going from 1/3 x to 1/2 x requires 4 gallons. So that means what? 1/3 x plus 4 is equal to 1/2 x. And that's this picture right here. And then solve for x. So x is 4 times 6, or 24. So full tank's capacity is 24 gallons. Look at the similarity between this process and this visual process. For some people, one method is better than other. You decide which you prefer, and it does not matter as long as you can solve the problem. You should write correct mathematically if you're writing it this way. All right, let's take the next problem. Why don't you pause the video here and see what you can do here. Again, how many meals? So let's take that as our variable. Let's say N is the number of meals that Jen purchased. So since the debit card is dropping from 800 down 450 for each meal, and we have N meals, we're going to have the following. 800 minus. Minus means you're taking away 450 for every meal. 450 times N, and that is $71. That's the balance on the card left. And then solve for N. You know how to do that now. Go ahead, pause the video and continue. All right, so you should end up with 162 for N. And so that means Jen purchased 162 meals. Now, how do you know if it's reasonable or not? 2 months, so that's like 60 days. Let's say you eat 2 meals a day, or 3 meals a day, depending on how many meals a day you eat. So 60 times 3 is about 180, and 60 times 2 is about 120. So that it's a reasonable amount of meals in the 2 months, even though it looks like a really big number. All right, try this on your own. Pause the video, please. All right, so draw a picture if you can, and let the unknown length of the property be determined by L. So we know that the width is 1/4 mile, and let's say this length is L miles. And area of a rectangle is length times width. And the perimeter is going to be 2 lengths plus 2 widths. Perimeter is given to you as 1.5 miles. So let's solve for L. And so the length is half a mile. And so the area of the property is going to be half times a quarter, or an eighth, 1/8 square miles. You should always write your answer in words in a sentence. All right, try that one on your own. So you have a situation where you need to mix yellow, blue, and red paints in the ratio of 3:2:4 to obtain a certain shade of paint. You've decided to make a batch with half of the numbers above. So half of 3 would be 1.5, half of that would be 1, half of that would be 2. So 1.5 cups to 1 cup to 2 cups of yellow, blue, and red paint accordingly. All right, now by accident, you started by putting in 2.5 cups of yellow and did not realize this until the 1 cup of blue and 2 cups of red had been mixed in. Should you start over or just add appropriate amount of blue and red so that you have the correct shade? So how much more blue and red should we add? That's the question. So go ahead and do that on your own. Pause the video. I'm going to show you a visual solution. So let's take a look. Here's our original paint combination. We have 3:2:4. 3 yellow cups, 2 blue cups, and 4 red cups. That's what's giving us the paint, the shade of the paint that we need. If you wanted to use half of that, then you would have to take 1.5 cups of yellow, 1 cup of blue, and 2 cups of red. That's what you plan. You planned on doing half the batch. Instead, what did you have? You did 2.5 cups of yellow. So before we can proceed further, let's just do what we did with the flower. Since I have 2 cups of red and 4 cups of 2 cups of blue and 4 cups of red, let's break everything into thirds so you can see that for every cup of yellow, you are going to need 2/3 of a cup of blue. And here we're going to have 1, 2, 3, 4. 4/3 cups of red. So for 1 cup of yellow paint, you need 2/3 cups of blue and 4/3 cups of red. Can you see that? So you're just breaking everything into 3 so that you can see what 1 cup of yellow corresponds to. All right, so we originally planned for half a batch, which was this much amount. But then we have, instead of 1.5, we have 2.5 cups of yellow. So 2.5 cups of yellow. So for this excess cup of yellow, we need to add 2/3 cup of blue and 4/3 cup of red. That's what we have to add extra. So you can see how visually this will be the answer then. So add 2/3 cup of blue and 1 1/3 cup of red, which is same as 4/3. That will preserve the shade and you don't have to start over.